We go. And we'll just double check and make sure that it is recording. Yep, there we go. Excellent. So we got everything up and running. Okay, so this is the project that I'm currently involved in, and we are actually, you know, doing the scrum thing. We are scrumming to get the the grant proposal done. So, you know, I can show you exactly what I mean by scrumming. Even though it's not like your software development, it's the same kind of approach.
The huddles, daily huddles.
Well, it's more like, you know, last minute panicking, and people are just going like, okay, you know, we need to get this done, you know, who's gonna do what? So this is the grant proposal. It's no big secret, you know, whatsoever. The CCC Maker Grant is something that the CCC, or the California Community College, okay, the Chancellor's Office, basically, got some money from industry, and then they wanted to push the whole concept of makerspace to community colleges. Again, they have, you know, specific goals of funding 1,000 paid internship by the end of the grant project itself, and so on. But I want to show you guys, you know, several things. One is, you know, we are using the Scrum approach. So you can see, you know, other people, you know, Professor Schuster, Randy Schuster from Design Technology, is actually working on the document, while, you know, me and Stower, Matt Stower, are also working on it at the same time. And then we also communicate on the side. You cannot see it right here because you know, we leave comments to each other, and then we, you know, talk about, you know, the issues that we have to deal with, how to edit the document and stuff like that. So it has the Scrum feel to it, because, you know, we just, you know, do it remotely every single day. Even though we are all on campus at different times, it's really hard to find a single time to meet, because, you know, our schedules just do not, you know, match in a consistent way. But this is interesting. Because if you go to the website, which is just cccmaker.com, okay, this is the web, the URL. They are basically, it's a two-year grant plan where, you know, we are in the first phase right now. We are doing what we call a self-study. And the self-study is basically just looking at the ARC community, both in terms of faculty and students, and see whether we have the capacity and also the potential to run a makerspace and actually be able to benefit our students and community as a whole by our makerspace, okay? So the objective, you know, of this particular grant is to build community among college makerspaces. And this is interesting because we are right next to Sierra College, and they have their own hacker lab already. Folsom Lake, you know, has something like that already, and we have something like that on this campus. If you take Design Technology 298, which is an internship program, or Design Technology 299, which is experimental offering, and they teach people how to use 3D printers. Okay, and then the objective is to fund, you know, 1,000 student internships. They're paid internships. And also share best practices in infusing making, innovation, and entrepreneurship into students' college and experience. Okay, so that to me is the interesting part, because that's what, you know, Hacker Lab has been trying to do. But Hacker Lab is a commercial entity, so you have to subscribe and pay money in order to take their classes. Not that our classes here is entirely free, but it is. It's definitely, you know, a little bit closer to the free side. Okay, so in this class, we are not making anything. We're not running 3D printers or anything like that. But I'm just thinking that, you know, in terms of internship, many of you may actually be, you know, interested in internships where, you know, somebody can take you, you know, into an actual workplace, and then you can work with somebody who's actually developing mobile apps. And you can be, you know, learning, you know, all the, you know, stuff from this, you know, professional person. And also, you know, on campus, part of this grant, or part of our plan for ARC, is we have internal consumers. In other words, you know, we have the resources to quote unquote make and invent and innovate, but we also have internal customers. I'll show you guys what I mean by that. So when we get to the shared portion, I'm showing you what the Design Technology Lab is doing, the DTL. OK, Okay, so we'll go to shared with me. And this is the design technology lab, which is room 309 on campus. When you go into the 2017 projects, these are the things that they are trying to do. Most of these are not really software or app, you know, kind of thing, but I can see some of these can benefit from, you know, running apps. But they're doing a lot of stuff that is actually beneficial to the campus itself. The Molecule Active Site Project is about taking the 3D model of a protein molecule, particle, and you do it, turn it into a 3D model. But it's not just 3D printed. This one is going to be laser cut in slices. So you know, students can actually take the protein apart at any particular place. It's kind of like a CAT scan. So you can take a slice and go like, oh, okay, I can see how it looks like, you know, at this particular slice of the particle. The guy who's doing this is kind of interesting too. He's an adjunct faculty for chemistry. And he's running his own server to do molecular modeling. Because with proteins, you know, because of all the degrees of freedom, proteins don't really come at, in a kind of static shape. You know, there are many ways to for protein to fold and swing and all kinds of degrees of freedom. So he has some kind of software to do a probabilistic plot of, you know, how the protein most of the time would look like. And so this is kind of interesting. The other one that's kind of interesting is tiny houses. Oh, this one is kind of interesting. Diesel Zilla is, have you guys been to the student center and see that Mecha Godzilla thing? Mini Mecha Godzilla, okay? So that's, you know, that's our Diesel Zilla. And what they want to do is to put it up as a display at the state fair this year, 2017 state fair. And that's not going to be very exciting, right? It's just a little clunk of steel. So what they are doing is they're inviting high schools to duke it out with Diesel Zilla using drones. So they would mount, you know, like small, you know, eye-safe, you know, laser devices on these drones, and then the drones will try to shoot into Diesel Zilla's mouth where they have sensors to sense, you know, whether Diesel Zilla is getting shot at. And then Diesel Zilla can also, if I remember correctly, it can respond and shoot back at the drones and stuff like that. So they're trying to get the high schools involved in this. Now this is where I think, you know, an app can potentially be useful to remotely control not the drones, but to control Diesel Zilla. Okay, so Diesel Zilla can actuate, you know, turn his head, you know, and shoot back, you know, the laser beams at the drones and whatnot, potentially. Okay, so this is the kind of stuff that our design tech lab is currently doing, and this is without the CCC Maker grant. So the idea of, you know, once we get the grant or the majority part of the grant, then we'll be able to make this a campus-wide resource. So we have a design hub, you know, within ARC that is interdisciplinary, okay, to focus on innovation, to focus on, you know, making ideas real, basically. Okay, we'll turn ideas into reality, materialize, you know, ideas. And I think in software, there's definitely a place that we, you know, as software people, can contribute to the design hub. So I just want to collect your thoughts, you know, in this class, because I think of all of my classes, this one is closest to, you know, actually, quote unquote, making something, to innovate, to actually, you know, put out a product instead of, oh, okay, I'm completing this class, I'm now transferring to a four-year university, which is great too. So what do you guys think? I mean, is this anything of interest? Because one of the major idea here is to get internship related to what you're doing or what you're studying. Does it seem useful to you, or? Okay, let's see some nods.
It's fine.
It is fine, okay.
It's fine, yeah.
Okay, so the idea of the internship in this case is, at this point, the DTL only has quote-unquote internal internship. In other words, the quote-unquote employer is ARC itself. So you're not actually working on any project in industry, but you're still getting the training. You know, the professor is running the DTL is running, you know, the lab just like a workplace. So he would talk about your work ethics, he would talk about how to be on time, you know, on schedule, you know, doing things with documentation. And I'm pretty sure Scrum has a place, you know, in an environment like that as well, okay? Because, you know, Scrum is all about, you know, on the, you know, just in time, okay, doing things, not really the last minute, but reacting to changes in a very agile way. Is that kind of a way to look at Scrum?
It's looking at what you have and where you want to be and go there.
Mm-hmm.
Short anchor.
And it's also very, very peer-to-peer. There's no, there's not a whole lot of structure when it comes to, you know, who is in charge of what.
And everybody's just a developer.
Yep. So I think, you know, in a Maker Lab, you know, that particular element is in most of the Maker Labs, you know, because people are just, you know, trying to get things done and they're not spending too much time on unnecessary management. So that's, you know, kind of interesting. So this is where we are, this is what I've been spending some time to work on, which is the self-study, you know, documentation. Because at this point, you know, we are not getting the majority of the fund yet. So the grant is giving each college $40,000, okay, for the resources that need to be put into the self-study and some of the other documents to basically show the college has the potential to do it. So if we are a small college, let's say with 1,500, you know, people enrollment in a place where it's mostly farmland, and most people are not, you know, studying anything that's related to technology, then, you know, the chances of us getting the grant is not all that good because, you know, that money is not going to be well spent. But ARC is a really big campus. We have 30 plus thousand, you know, students enrollment. We have a lot of, you know, departments, and some of the things that the DTL does is internal, like anthropology. Okay, they had the DTL to print a FEMA bone. Okay, from a early ancestor of humans. So now they can actually pass that bone, quote unquote bone, around, which is actually plastic, in class. So the students can actually touch it, feel it, look at the size of it, and so on and so forth. And if they drop it and break it, hey, you know, just pay for, you know, $5 worth of plastic and print it out again. So they don't have to deal with, you know, like fragile items like that. So, and then another project is mapping out the campus. You'll do a 3D model of the entire campus itself. And you can see one person just kind of popped in. Let me check out who that is. This is Randy, and this is Matthew. So Matt Stoller is on it as well. So right there, Scrum. Because, you know, we all work on the document at the same time, and then we just leave comments to each other or do the chat online so that we can figure out exactly what to do with some items, and we'll get things resolved like on the fly, just like that. So it's mini Scrum, I guess. It's not like a full Scrum. We don't do sprints, we don't do backlogs, though there is such a concept
of
backlog.
It's not Scrum. Scrum is actually a defined methodology. So Agile is the collection of all those things which are lightweight methodologies,
mm-hmm.
that, you know, focus on moving forward. So it's Agile.
It's Agile?
It's Agile.
I thought Scrum is an implementation of Agile. It's putting Agile into practice.
You can do Agile with Scrum.
Okay.
But you can do Scrum and not be Agile.
Ah, okay. Because Agile refers to the actual development model that is specific to software development.
Yeah, lightweight methodologies,
okay.
Lightweight processes.
Gotcha. Yep. So I don't have enough screen space here to show you the comments. Well, I guess I do, but it's not easy to see. But this is how we communicate with each other while we're working on the document. So we will document, you know, all the things. You can look at this kind of like a backlog. Okay, because it does show unresolved items, except it's not in the list, okay? And nobody has time to actually bother to plot the burn up chart and the burn down chart and stuff like that. So we don't do that, you know, with this, because we're really just, you know, trying to hustle and get it out by the 17th. So anyway, so this is kind of interesting because it relates to what we talk about in this class in multiple ways. So if you, yeah, go ahead.
What's the goal of the grant, I guess? What's the goal? Like, is it to help education inside the college, or is it to help businesses, or is it to spin off small?
It's all of the above.
Okay.
So when you look at the Maker Project, okay, so here is funded by the CCCCO, which is the Chancellor's Office, with Doing What Matters. I have no idea what that is. with Sierra College as the fiscal agent, which means that they are the ones who are in charge of distributing the funds and stuff like managing the funds, and technical assistance provider, and this is kind of interesting, the CCC Maker Project. It provides mini grant to support college makerspaces, builds community among college makerspaces, which means that they want the colleges to talk to each other in an open fashion. So, you know, when we do something and we find, oh, this is really good, it's successful, we don't keep it a secret. This is not an ARC thing. We want to share that with all the other colleges who are, you know, doing the same thing. Offer faculty professional development. So basically, this is PD, what we call, you know, pre-PD on campus, is we will invite other people, you know, who manage, you know, maker spaces, and come here and tell us, you know, how they do things, and we can borrow some of the ideas if it is applicable and stuff like that. But what is more important is the fund or the grant project wants to fund 1,000 student internships. And in other words, they want to push students to work in industry while they're still students, so they can learn, you know, what it is like to work in industry, not particularly the skills or the technical stuff, but also the soft skills of how to work in the real workplace. Share best practices in infusing, making innovation and entrepreneurship into students' college experience, and prepare them for STEM/STEAM, the A is for art careers. So the whole thing is really trying to boost the California economy by pushing out more students who are, you know, basically who learn how to innovate, how to become entrepreneurs. Okay, so this way, you know, the state itself as a whole can benefit, because now we have more people who are, you know, innovators, who are entrepreneurs. Yep.
Well, just a thought. If they went spin-offs, they should probably pull in the business and the art people into the fold, so you can form an actual team that can actually.
You mean on campus, as far as faculties are concerned?
Faculties
concerned?
Or other students who.
Mm-hmm.
If someone who's interested in running maybe a business side, you look at it differently than someone who's.
I agree with you 100%. When we go back to the actual document, which is this one. Matt Storr is from Art New Media.
Okay, he's art. Okay,
so he is from Art New Media, and then Randy basically ran, well, I guess a part of a business for 20 years before he became a professor. So he still has a lot of connection in industry. And as a result, you know, he's the guy who knows, you know, okay, this is how people should, you know, behave when they're at work, you know, work ethics, and, you know, all the other things that people, you know, really need to know, you know, of how to behave as an employee. So he's the one who is also, you know, doing that part as well. But I do agree that the business department probably, you know, need to be involved at some point, because they are the ones, you know, who understand the business side of things. Okay, so I have a great idea, okay? It's gonna take me X amount of money to crank out the first 100 units. And then from that point on, you know, I think I can sell, let's say, 1,000 units. So is it a viable business? Well, you look at the numbers, right? You have to look at the numbers, you have to look at, okay, I don't have enough money to buy the equipment and the material and hire the people to make the first 100. What do I do about it? You have to borrow money. How do I borrow money? How do I get the funding that I need? Well, these days there are a lot more alternatives than 10 years ago. Kickstart is one, and then how many other, you know, online?
Yeah.
Sorry?
GoFundMe.
GoFundMe.
Indiegogo.
Okay. So we have a lot more ways to collect the funding in order to have a startup, but then you have to know how to push your idea, because you're not walking into Wells Fargo Bank and talk to a banker anymore. Okay, you're now talking to hundreds of thousands of people. How do you convince those people and say, oh, you know, I want you to chip in 15 bucks, 20 bucks, 50 bucks, okay? And in return, you'll be the first one to get the product. So I think that's a new idea, and I'm not really sure whether our business department is up to date on those things or not. Because, you know, these are really fast developments, and
Right. There's things like cash flow, upsizing your manufacturing. There's all
right.
sorts of businessy sides that you're not going to ask necessarily a software person to,
that's correct.
To break what they're doing to go do that.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't know if they teach that level here or not. But
I think they do. You know, they do look into. We have accounting classes, so you know, in accounting classes, I'm pretty sure they have to get into. You know, how the general ledger, you know, how do you classify expenses, you know, what are considered incomes and so on and so forth. So I'm pretty sure collectively they have enough knowledge, but do they have a single person, you know, kind of like a focal point that can do all of this stuff? That I do not know. But that's a really great idea, is to bring business, you know, people into this whole project so they can handle the entrepreneur part of the whole thing, the money part.
The money, the numbers.
Exactly.
And you also have the engineering department, electrical.
We don't really have a very big engineering department. We have ET, which is electronics technology.
Okay.
But their focus is not engineering. They do not transfer to engineering of a four-year university. So they focus more on technician kind of jobs. You know, how do you splice a fiber optic cable? You know, how do you hook up the networking of something? That sort of thing. The engineering department on this campus is relatively small, and they focus mostly on drafting, you know, 3D, you know, drafting and, you know, how to use AutoCAD, that sort of thing, more so than electrical engineering or mechanical engineering that we usually think of when we think of engineering. So that's kind of not as applicable to on this campus than some of the other campuses. Okay, so this is kind of cool. And I also got, you know, so let's get back to Android programming. I'm hoping that those of you who took CISP 362, or if you kind of played with App Inventor, you know there's a clock device or clock component in App Inventor, and that's how you can get a tick, right, periodic tick, so that you have control over, okay, every 1 second I want to do da-da-da-da, okay? So that's going to be our today, the focus of today's class, today's lecture. I did not have enough time to type up the notes, okay, and I apologize for that, and that's on my backlog right now. High on the list, backlog, document, you know, how to use a timer. But I can show you how to do it, and I can explain the concepts, okay, so that's the part that we can do here. And we'll get back to this later. Right, so I don't really exactly have to log in, but the project is already on the shared drive for those of you who kind of want to download it and play with it while we talk about it, okay? So let's go ahead, I'll just kind of go there. So we'll go to my drive, 363, shared. And the name of the file is testtimer.zip, okay? We just, you know, I just zip it up and uploaded about an hour ago. Okay, save file. And we can put it here. Oh, I got one already. Because I was actually working on this project using the live setup and not using my usual desktop setup. That has to do with my usual desktop setup. It's still using IA32. You know, it's using the 32-bit platform, and the emulator would not work. So that's why, you know, I just use my live distribution to do it, which is good because, you know, this makes sure that I can use my own setup for, you know, these projects, making sure everything does work. And I think, you know, for a system running out of an external hard drive, this starts up pretty fast. There we go. So we got, you know, everything here. All right, so the program does work. Let me show you how it works first, and then we'll go back and look at how it was written, because the way it's written is kind of convoluted, but it is kind of necessarily so. I'm just using software rendering because I don't have the necessary driver for the graphics card on these computers. Okay. something that is really simple in CISP 362, you know, setting up a timer or a clock component to give us a certain tick, you know, at a certain interval, turns out to be an adventure in, you know, Android Studio. And it has to do with the underlying concepts of your threading and how there's only one single thread that can touch user interface elements. But your timer is running as a different thread, so you need some kind of communication between the UI thread, the user interface thread, and the thread that is actually responsible for running the timer. So that is actually what where the complexity comes in. For those of you who took CISP 362, you know, what is your thought on Android Studio and, you know, versus App Inventor?
There's a lot more control, obviously.
Okay.
The limitations of App Inventor are very, very obvious once you start getting through the meat and bone. You find, like, you want to do this, and it's not really available. I found that the drag and drop block thing was good. Or being able to, well, actually, no, I didn't like it very much at all. I like it. It is very tedious, especially when you want to write subroutines.
Okay.
The biggest problem with App Inventor is that if you try writing a big program, you'll have so many blocks that will actually lag your computer out.
Because all those blocks are done by JavaScript, okay? You know, and JavaScript, you know, chews up memory like there's no tomorrow, too. Yep, so the program should be running, and it's just, you know, okay, there you go. So we have a very simple timer app that updates a, you know, count on screen. You know, it's basically on every single second. Woohoo! Okay, but how does it work, right? I mean, this is a program where you don't have to click anything. So how are these events generated to begin with, and how do we update the text view on screen? So now we'll take a quick look at the program itself. Okay. So we got a few things. The major concepts that we have to deal with is, first of all, you know, we need to understand what is a handler. We need to understand what is a runnable. There's a timer task involved. Okay. And then we also have to understand how to set up a timer. Okay. So those are the things that we have to understand. And as you probably expect, you know, in order to do all of these things, we have to start somewhere. And the place that we can start off with is an Android timer. And I think a timer is not exactly an Android concept. It is probably a Java concept, more so than it is an Android concept. And I was right about it, too, because you can see how the timer is not belonging to an Android package. It belongs to a Java package, which is basically saying, okay, what you learned about timer is applicable to any Java program, not just Android programming. Okay, so we'll go ahead and take a quick look at this one. It's a facility for threads to schedule tasks for future execution in a background thread. Okay, just highlight this one single sentence, because, you know, at first glance, okay, this is easy, okay? It's some kind of thingy for other thingies to schedule other thingies for future execution in the background thingy. Okay, but it's actually a lot more than that, because each term has a very specific meaning. Threads, what exactly is a thread? Okay, so let me highlight those things. So a thread is a particular concept. In this context, it has a very, very specific meaning. A task is not a thread, okay? So a task, once again, has a very specific meaning, and also execution in the background thread, you know, that's also, you know, it has a specific meaning. So the first thing we need to do is to understand what a thread is. For those of you who have heard about multi-threading, multi-processing, multitasking, they are not the same thing. So how is it different? What exactly is a thread? What do you think? So I'll let you guys talk first, and then I'll kind of chime in and clarify. Go ahead.
It's a separate software, set of software running concurrent with other software.
A thread is more of a, when you write a program, you are thinking for the most part as a single individual thread. Linear, exactly. So you have a linear way of looking at the execution of a program. And that's basically what a thread is. It's just a linear artifact or a linear execution of the code of a particular program is a quote-unquote thread. Go ahead.
Well, I'm thinking about you have a lot of listeners. You can have multiple occurrences of separate things happening somewhere simultaneously. You have to deal with all of these things at the same time.
Sort of at the same time, but they're not really at the same time.
Jump around because the process are like different things at the same time. But I'm just thinking there's a sort of logical breadcrumb trail following behind where the starting from where it's going to, and you have multiple versions of this, and you have to be able to know which one is which. And so, linear.
Okay.
It's a loop of execution that's common with other loops of execution within the same process.
Okay, that's a very good explanation of what a thread is. Okay, any other attempts? Okay, so a thread is basically just one linear execution of a program. Okay, so there are attributes related to a thread from the operating system perspective. A thread has its own stack, okay, which is used for calling subroutines and stuff like that. A thread has its own register set, okay? So it doesn't interfere with other threads, so they can be quote-unquote executing in parallel, and they can do that in true parallelism when you have a multi-core processor, okay? But a thread also shares resources with other threads, okay? So when think back in CISP 430 or 400 or even 360, okay? So C++ programming. Global variables are shared. You can have a single program in execution, which is called a process. But the process can spin off any number of threads that are executing in quote-unquote parallel. But all of those threads will share objects. They will share everything that is in the heap. So in Java terms, anything that you knew, okay, they're dynamically allocated. And those things are shared within, amongst all the threads of the same process. The stack is not, okay? So that all the threads can call and return from subroutines, completely independently. So that's what a thread is. A task, on the other hand, also has a special meaning in this case. A task is basically something that is scheduled in the future, so it has a time and what needs to be done associated with it. Okay, so a task is basically something that you can schedule but by itself, it is not something they can run. Okay? It has something that can run inside of it, but it really is just the time, when is what supposed to be done. Okay, so you specify the when, you specify the what. Tasks may be scheduled for one-time execution, so it's a one-shot, or for repeated execution at regular intervals, which is what this program is setting up. Now the next sentence here is even more important. So it says right here that corresponding to each timer object is a single background thread that is used to execute all of the timers, in this case, that timer object's tasks sequentially. Okay, so this sentence, this is obviously written by a programmer or someone who's extremely technical, because all these words have special meaning, but it doesn't really bother to explain, this is a special thing, this is a special word, and so on. So each timer object that you allocate and you initialize, when you say new timer, open, close paren, is corresponding to a single background thread. A background thread is really just a thread that does not interact directly with the user interface. So it's sitting in the background, ticking away, and its only job in this case is to execute the timer's tasks. And the emphasis here is sequentially. In other words, all the tasks associated with a particular timer are really executed sequentially. If you schedule two things, two particular tasks, and they're supposed to execute at exactly the same moment, they're not actually going to be executed, you know, at the same time concurrently. They'll be in they will be executed sequentially. It's just that one is slightly ahead of the other one. And then time a task should complete relatively quickly, because you don't want to have one task not done when the next task is supposed to begin. Okay, that would be kind of like a really bad scenario. And it tells you what's going to happen, you know, if that is to happen, you know, if it hogs the execution task, or if it hogs the execution thread, then it can in return delay the execution of all of the other tasks. You're basically pushing everything down, which may quote unquote bunch up and execute in rapid succession when the offending task finally completes. Okay, so that's kind of, you know, what's going to happen, you know, in real life as well. So you can basically look at one thread as a single worker working away with the so-called tasks, and you can look at those tasks as items on your calendar, on your Google Calendar. So one particular item on your Google Calendar is a task, okay? At what time you're supposed to do what, okay? And then a person who is looking at the calendar is the thread. Is that okay? So for the most part, if there's no task, the person, the thread, can basically just say, I'm going to set up an alarm clock and I'm going to go to sleep. Or in hibernation in this case, because you don't want a thread to needlessly consume CPU cycles. So if you don't want that to happen, you basically just put a thread into a sleep queue. This is an OS or operating system concept where the thread does not even use up any resources. You can kind of page it off, you know, so that it doesn't even consume much RAM either. But usually a thread, the representation of a thread is really lightweight and you can keep it in RAM, but it won't be consuming execution resources. All right, so the rest, you know, is not as useful. This is introduced, Java 5.0 introduced the concept of concurrency, but that's not what we're doing here. So we'll go ahead and take a look at the constructor of a timer. We are only using the most simple one. We are just, you know, using a, you know, the first one, which is, you know, not passing any parameters to it. The second one, you know, let you specify a timer which starts a new thread, but the new thread is going to run as a daemon. Okay, so if you right click on this one, it explains what it means to be running as a daemon. So a daemon thread versus a user thread has to do with a daemon is running in, quote unquote, not only the background, but has no interaction capability with the end user. Okay, so there are special meanings also attached to, you know, daemon. In Linux, a daemon is basically a process that has no connection to standard input nor standard output, so it has no I/O capabilities whatsoever. Because a normal process in Linux automatically has standard in, which we know as, you know, cin in C++, and cout, you know, which is standard output, which also we learned from C++. So those two files, along with standard err and standard aux, those are, you know, automatically opened for any process. But once you turn a process into a daemon process in Linux, then those files basically go away. You know, you don't have any way to communicate using the standard files. Now, does it mean that daemon has no input-output capability? No, because that would be a useless process if it has no way to communicate with the outside world. So a daemon would usually communicate with the outside world using different means, including sockets. Okay, now that's a concept that we're not going to talk about in this class. But a socket is, well, not in details, but to understand what a socket is it is a many-to-one type of communication interface. Think about a web server, okay? A web server is a very good example of using a socket. So the server has one single receiving socket and say that, okay, this is port 80 of 192.168.1.1, okay? So you associate the IP address and the port number as the external address of a quote-unquote socket. then you can now have multiple clients connecting to that single socket of the server, and the connections can be simultaneous. In other words, you can have client A, client B, and client C. They're all making a connection, and they're all downloading something big, and the connections are slow. So now you can the server has to maintain three simultaneous connections to three different clients all at the same time. That is what a socket can do. In this class, I don't know whether we'll have time to get into sockets, because sockets are mostly related to daemons. But if we do have time to get into that, that can be very interesting, because it's a major operating system concept that can change the way you look at how programs interact with each other. Okay, so for the time being, we'll just say that, okay, we're not using any daemon process in this case, so we just have a regular timer. When you look at the methods of a regular timer, it has cancel, okay? So cancel this timer, discarding any scheduled task. It is equivalent to a person looking at the Google Calendar and just say, I'm gonna delete everything on my Google Calendar. Forget it, I'm not gonna do anything. I'm taking a break. I'm going on vacation. Okay, so purge is to remove all canceled tasks from the timer's task queue. Okay, so not only, so it's all gone, okay? Terminating this timer. So cancel is going to terminate the timer in addition to purging. Purging is saying, okay, I'll just go on vacation, but I'm not going to die. Cancel means the timer is going to die. It's going to be terminated along with the thread that this timer is associated with. But most of the calls are scheduling calls. You can schedule a specific task which has its own class or its own interface for repeating fixed delay execution. So you can delay first and then you specify the period. You can also specify schedule at fixed rate. So this is fixed rate execution beginning after the schedule delay. The other one is fixed delay. Okay, so what is the difference between fixed rate versus fixed delay? The difference is very subtle, okay? It all has to do with the word rate versus the word delay. What is the difference? And in which situation should I use which one?
Rate happens at the same time on the clock, and delay happens at the time after you call the timer.
Exactly, okay, very good. So when you look at it from the timing diagram perspective, a fixed rate basically means, okay, this, you are fixing the amount of time when a task begins, okay? So let's say the first task takes this long, the second task, just a little bit of time, the third one takes a lot longer, and this one takes this long. It doesn't matter, because the start time of the task is still fixed. This is fixed rate. And you specify the delay, not the delay, but you specify the period in this case, between the start time of the tasks. When you look at fixed delay, then the situation is going to be different because it is basically saying after the task, how long do I wait for the next task to begin? But you look at it from the perspective of the end of a task. So now you're saying this much time is fixed. Then I start the next task. Oh. Then I look at the same amount of time to start the next one. This one takes a lot longer. It doesn't matter. Okay, I'm going to delay this much time before I start the next one. So from the timing diagram, you can now see how this time here, which is passed as period in both cases. In one case, period is measured between the start time of tasks. In the second case, it is measured from the end of one task to the beginning of the next task. So that's the minor difference. It is very subtle, and depending on what kind of task you're dealing with and what is the period that you're dealing with, they can look almost exactly the same. Because if the time it takes to execute a task is really short relative to the period, you may not see anything until a lot later. Then you start to see the skew of the time, and then you start to have problems. It's like, oh, this is supposed to be every single second. It seems to work for the first few minutes, but if you have a few days, then you can see how the time is shifting by an hour or something like that. Question?
So you've got delay, you're passing in that first one there, delay and period. So
right.
What's the reasoning with that?
The delay, the first, this is the initial delay.
Okay.
I think it really is the initial delay.
Beginning after the specified, yeah.
Yeah, so beginning after the specified delay. So this is the initial delay. All right. So, and these are all measured in milliseconds, okay, or thousandth of a second. All right. So now we know that, you know, in order to use a timer, you can always just allocate a timer object, have a timer thread associated with it, and not to do anything about it. But if you want the timer to do something, you have to schedule, you know, a task, okay? And these tasks are called timer tasks. So the next thing we need to do is to investigate, okay, what is a timer task? So we write it on the timer task, they're all the same. And then we look into what a timer task is. Once again, it is a Java concept, it is not an Android concept. A task that can be scheduled for one time or repeated execution by a timer. That's a very simple explanation. And so we want to look at, okay, so what exactly are the methods associated with a timer? And one thing we want to also know is this is an abstract class, which means you cannot have objects of this class, you know, allocated or initialized. You have to derive a subclass of this so that your subclass is no longer an abstract class. And the abstract component has to do with it implements runnable. And runnable is an interface. So we'll get to that part too.
So the runnable interface implements all the abstract methods for the timer task?
So all subclasses of timer task has to implement runnable. Or
so
it has to
that fulfills the contract for the abstract class.
Correct. So the subclasses no longer need to implement runnable because the superclass is implementing runnable, but the subclasses have to supply the runnable method or the method that is expected by runnable because it is now an abstract method in timer task. Right, so look at the summary. It has one single protected constructor. It's just, you know, the usual constructor. It has no arguments. It has cancel. Basically, you're canceling an appointment on your calendar. That's basically what cancel is. Is it will just say that, okay, this task is no longer, you know, active. It has a abstract method called run, and a long method called scheduled execution time. So scheduled execution time is basically you're clicking on your smartwatch and say, how much time do I have until a particular event? So it's gonna tell you in milliseconds, you know, how much time do you have until this particular task is going to execute. It's useful in some cases, but in most cases, it's not gonna be that useful.
It looks to me, it shows you the drift between what the current time is and when it was scheduled to execute.
Returns the scheduled execution time of the most recent actual execution of this task. Scheduled execution time.
So that would be the what time it was scheduled to run, and then you could take the difference between what time it is now and calculate your drift.
And the most recent actual execution.
So you're supposed to start off at 9 a.m., but it's really 9:01. Right? You look at the clock, it says it's 9:01, but you were scheduled to run at 9 a.m.
But it only returns this part. It does not tell you about the actual execution time.
Correct. It would return 9 a.m.
Right.
Even if it was 9:01.
But you don't know how much it has drifted looking at this.
Well, you just check the current time.
You have to compare that to the current time, which is systems dot, I think, current time in milliseconds. Yep. So it's not to the next one, it's to the actual one that happened already.
When it was supposed to happen.
When it's supposed to happen. Okay, so run is the one that we're interested in because this is the abstract method that has to be supplied by a subclass to specify, okay, so what exactly do you want to do when this task, you know, it runs. So run is interesting. And in order to understand this run, okay, it doesn't tell you a whole lot, okay? It gives you some idea of what you can put into run. And this is your tardiness, because, you know, just as you said, it is using the current time in milliseconds, and you subtract the set schedule execution time so that you can tell, you know, how much time has drifted. And if it is beyond a certain maximum tardiness, then you just, you know, say, too late, don't do anything, because, you know, this particular task is, you know, way too tardy.
So will it overrun a clock, or will it just queue it if we fall behind?
If you fall behind, this one, you know, it's basically giving you a choice right here.
That's right. This allows us to skip it.
Yeah, so this is a skipping mechanism, and basically say if you're too late to do something, don't bother to do it, just skip it. And so the return returns immediately. So this task is basically, quote unquote, you know, canceled, you know, on the fly when, you know, it is, when it's time to do it. But whether you want to do it this way is entirely up to you. All right, so this is time, and then we have runnable, which is a interface. And runnable as an interface doesn't really do a whole lot, okay? The only thing it requires is we have to have a void method called run, okay? And that's it. You know, anything, any class that has a single method called, you know, run that returns void can pass the test and be classified as a runnable, as an interface. Okay, so that makes it pretty easy to deal with. Okay, so now we have all the concepts, you know, at this point. So you might think, oh, that's easy, okay? If I just need to update the timer, you know, update the time on the screen using a label, I can just go ahead and associate the code used to update the label inside a timer task as its run method, okay?
You can write to the user interface from a separate thread?
You cannot, that's the problem, okay? So I'm gonna illustrate what the problem is first, and then we'll fix the problem, okay? So the solution that you are downloading from the from my share drive already is the correct solution, okay? But what I want to do is to give you the incorrect solution, which is not a solution, it doesn't work. But it makes sense to most people. Okay, so I'm gonna say timer does not work. And use that as my application name. There we go. And next. Okay, so we'll just take all the defaults. There we go. So just remember, you know, this is the one that does not work, okay? So I want to illustrate, you know.
But don't do this.
Yeah, do not do this, but it's really obvious, okay? The error message in Java will tell you exactly what is wrong with it, okay? But I do want to go through the process because, you know, some of this code can be recycled, can be reused, but the most important part cannot, okay? So we'll let, you know, Gradle is done. Okay, so we can now, you know, do all this stuff. Okay, so we'll go ahead and initialize, you know, all the variables. So we know we need a timer, and because we have a timer, we also need to have the timer task. And then with a timer task, we need to specify what to run, what to do when it runs. Okay, so those are the things that we need to do. So we need our own class. Well, okay, we can do it in one single statement here. Okay, and the way I'm going to do this is to do it at override, and I'll do it in on resume. Okay, so public, I think it's a void on resume. Okay, I personally like to put the braces on a separate line, the open brace on a separate line, but that takes up more line numbers. And most people like to do it this way. I'd like to see the open and closed curly braces aligned, but that's just my little thing.
I like it too. I've been trying to get used to doing it like that, but I still like it the other way.
Yeah,
I like to do it on my methods, but when I do it on my ifs and stuff,
yeah.
I prefer see it more nested as opposed to using
that too.
But on the method declaration, absolutely, this is the cleanest way to go.
Yep. preferences. And that's why Python is so good, because what curly braces are we talking about? There's no curly braces. But the indentations become important.
Yeah.
Yep. All right, so on resume, you know, we're gonna, you know, okay, the difference between on create and on resume is when you get to on resume, it means the program is becoming interactive, okay? That is the on resume event. So I'm gonna do it on resume because, you know, until the UI is ready and ready to go, I'm not gonna do a single thing. So I'm not doing it in the on create, I'm just doing it on resume. Okay. You don't want to put this code into on resume because, you know, you're missing the only chance to inflate the layout. So certain things you have to do on create, in on create. Okay, so on resume, we're gonna set up the timer. Okay, so we'll say it can be a local variable because the timer, once it is set up, you know, nobody needs to access it again. You know, this particular app doesn't really want to do anything with the timer once it is all set up. So we can have a local variable, so timer. My timer, okay, and it knows exactly what to do. I'll enter, you know, put that, you know, import in here. I was about to say pound include from C++, you know, but Java has a much cleaner way of doing things like that with import. So we just say this is a new timer, okay, and I will use the one that has no parameter to the constructor because we can now say my timer dot schedule. Whoops, typo. Schedule at fixed rate, okay, because I wanted to execute every second to count the seconds. So the first thing we need to do is to supply, okay, who is the timer task? Now, timer task is a class, but it's an abstract class. I cannot create a method, you know, like that. And I don't think I can create an anonymous class in this place. Does anyone know whether we can do an anonymous class out of a superclass? I don't think it can be done. We can try it. New timer task. Nope, doesn't let me do it. Cannot resolve timer task. Well, that's because it doesn't even know that timer task is in use. But this is also a context where it doesn't trigger the alt enter mechanism. So I'm going to take it as no. All right, fine. We can define our own nested class here, okay? So we can say class myTimerTask extends timerTask, okay? And now it knows, you know, how to do the import. That's good. And the complaint is, oh, you know, because it is extending an abstract class, it has to supply either the abstract class itself, it remains abstract, or we have to, you know, supply the actual method. Okay, so we'll supply the actual method here. We can say run, which returns void. And it complains because it is supposed to be public. There we go. That makes it go away. All right, so now we can set it up to update the text, the label, which means the label needs to have an ID. We'll go ahead and fix that because, you know, by default, it doesn't have an ID. So we'll just go ahead and fix it, give it an ID so we can address that. Okay, use the missing styles. Why would they have this problem here? There we go. So we click on the label, we give it a name. Okay, we'll just call this, you know, label. Okay, because that's sufficient for what we're doing. And then we go back to main here. So we now can right after we set content view, you know, that's after we inflate the user interface from the layout, then all the objects are created. So right at this point, we can now see, okay, who is our label? So we say text view, which is the type or the class of a label. Alt enter, put it in. And then we just say your label is text view find view by ID, and it is r.id.label in this case. It doesn't know it yet because we haven't saved all the files, and it just internally it is not consistent at this point. When we compile, it'll get it fixed. Okay, so now we can say, okay, when you run, we have two things to do. We have to update the counter itself. So we need an integer, you know, as our counter, and we'll initialize the counter to zero. And then over here, there are two things we need to do. The first one is incrementing the counter, and then the second one is to update the label. So we say labels dot set text, and it is going to be a class method, a static method of the class string, value of, and then we supply the actual integer to convert into a string. And that's it. Okay, looks pretty simple. And this one is complaining only because it has not rebuilt yet. So the label in the resource file is not known to the editor on this side. So we'll go ahead and do a build, make project, and I think all the errors should go away. Oh, okay, fine, semicolon. And we also have to set the rate and also the finish of the program, basically. Okay, so it is time to make a my timer task. Okay, so we'll just say this is a timer task is new. I can just put a new inside there too, but we can always put it outside. New my timer task doesn't need any parameters. There we go. So in here, when we are doing the scheduling, we have to say what to do, and that is represented by timer task, right? And then we also have to specify the delay to the first one. We'll put a zero here, and then we'll also specify the period between the ticks, and because we need it to update every 1 second, which is 1,000 milliseconds. Okay, so I think that should be good. Let's go ahead and build it. And it complains about the label not found. Here's the label. There we go. Now it doesn't complain anymore. Okay, so let's try it one more time. Okay, excellent. We can now run it. Why is it building again? I just built it.
Does it rebuild depending on the target version of the emulator?
It should not.
So it uses the same code regardless?
Yeah, it should be using the same code. Okay. And we have this, and there's a long delay, and then it crashed. Timer doesn't work has stopped, because timer doesn't work. Well, that's why we named it timer doesn't work, because it doesn't work. Okay, but now this is the important part. You have to read the messages, because it will tell you, where is that terminal? No, Android monitor, there we go. Okay, Android monitor is giving us all the feedback that we need to look at. It's really long, but we need to read the first message, which is here. Unfortunately, it is also on a very long line. And it says right here, java.lang runtime exception. And it says unable to instantiate activity component info. And it says right here, attempt to invoke virtual method on a no object reference. Oh, okay. That's because I have not set the ID, set up label as a. Oh, okay. I did it at the wrong place. This is not a good place to do it. We have
it's
to do it.
It's not set up yet.
Yeah, it's not set up yet, so we will do it over here. Label, paste, there we go. Okay, so that will fix that problem. Not the problem that I want to illustrate, but. Okay, so once again, it's running, and once again, we have problems, but this time it's a different problem. So we'll go back and take a look at that problem. Fatal exception, which means there's no way to continue execution in this case. And when we scroll all the way over, keep going. Did not call through. Okay, fine. That's what needs is on
resume
here. We have to call the super method first. Super dot on resume. I keep forgetting that. Okay. So
what's the error message?
Oh, it's cool enough. I mean, it does tell you something.
Getting the job done.
Yep, gets the job done. It knew that it did not call through to super, which is good, which is great. So I think it detects it, you know, somewhere else that something is supposed to be initialized was not initialized. And it's coming from, I'm just trying to see where it's coming from. It's coming from perform resume activity. So there has to be some kind of flag that is, you know, missing, that is not being set when it's supposed to. That's how we can detect it. The superclass method did not get called. Great, excellent. Okay, one more time. Third time is a charm. Okay, but crashes again, which is what we want. But the question is it crashing for the right reason? Okay, so we'll, okay, this is great. This is the right one. Only the original thread that created a view hierarchy can touch its views. What is it talking about? This is all inside the definition of main activity. What is the problem? Well, class nesting has nothing to do with which thread is executing the code. One is completely static, okay? So class nesting is completely static. It's just controlling the scope of which class is visible from which other class. That's what your class nesting is about, okay? But which code or which thread is executing the code corresponding to a method, that's a whole different thing. Okay, so what we want to do is to separate the class definitions, because we do have this, you know, nested class here, which is, you know, a nested class. It is a class definition within a class definition. But it doesn't mean that this code is going to be executed by the task that, you know, ran on create, on resume, and stuff like that, you know, because that is the task, or that's the thread, sorry, that is the thread that is responsible for the user interface. Who's going to run this code?
The timer task
is attached to a timer, and then there's one thread attached to each timer object. And that thread is created when we say new timer. Okay? So let's go back to on resume. The moment this call is done, there is a new thread created in the system associated with what my timer is referring to. Is that okay? That thread has no relationship whatsoever to the thread that is running in order to get that new thread created, other than they're in the same process. So on resume itself is in the UI thread, the user interface thread, the one that is responsible to handle all the, you know, click events, the one who's updating the user interface, inflating the user interface, and stuff like that. That's the thread that is running on resume. But in the process of running on resume, it is creating a new thread. It's spinning off a new thread that is tied into the timer object that my timer is referring to. So that's a separate thread that we just created. Timer task, which is this one here, is merely specifying what to do when it is time to do something. In other words, timer task itself is not attached to any particular thread. It is attached to a timer. Is that okay? And the attachment to the timer is done by the constructor, or the, excuse me, not the constructor, but, you know, with the method call to my timer. So there are these three processes. The first one, okay, let me comment it here. This will make it more clear. Okay, create new timer object and new thread. Okay, so the key is a new thread is created on this line. The second one is creating a task, okay? Create a new task. And the task is like a calendar event, okay? So this is basically just a calendar entry. And then the third one is attach the calendar entry, attach the task that we just created to the thread that is running the timer. So that means timer task is not attached to the user interface thread, which is running at this point. It is attached to the thread that is supposed to run that's supposed to run every second. Are we doing okay so far with these concepts? There are two threads involved. Yep. Say that one more time.
What did you say? The timer task is not attached.
The timer task is not attached to the user interface thread. It is attached to the thread associated with the timer that we just created. So that's why we saw the error message. The error message said, you know, oh, we cannot touch the user, we cannot touch the view because we're not in the thread that created the view in the first place. That's what the error message was about. Okay? So this doesn't work. How do we fix this? In other words, how can I have the thread that is associated with a timer and say, well, I can't do a single thing about the user interface, so I'm going to tell the user interface thread and say, hey, you know, I cannot touch your stuff, so you go do this. I'm going to give you a scheduled task to do it. That's what we need to do. Okay. So are there any questions about why this does not work? Okay, it has to do with the thread that is running, trying to update the text view, is not the thread that created and be responsible to manage the user interface. Question?
Yep. Yeah, not about why it doesn't work, but you said that you said not to do it in onCreate because of something about inflation. What was that?
Okay, there are certain things you cannot do with onCreate. Okay, so this one here, this one has to be done after set content view because I had that initialization up here originally. But until this is called, the XML file, which specifies, you know, what components you have in the user interface, those things are quote unquote not inflated yet, which means, you know, the objects associated with all the views are not in existence yet. So when I make this call, here, up here, it's going to return a null for sure.
Okay. But you could start the timer in onCreate if you wanted to, right?
I could start the timer here?
In onCreate, as long as you did it after?
Yes, I could. Yep, I could do it over here. OnCreate, by the time you get to onCreate.
The timer will always run even if you back out of the application.
Sorry?
The timer would continue to run when you back out of the application. So your onResume allows you to suspend it on pause.
Yeah, because on resume and on pause are like parentheses. You know, one starts and the other one ends.
So it's a resource thing.
It's a resource thing because, you know, when you have a dialog box, you know, appearing on top of the application, you may not want, you know, things to be updating in the background anymore. So it's a resource management. So you're not hogging resources when it's not going to make any difference. Okay, so this is not working. You know, we need some way to have the timer thread. Oh, that was another question too. Sorry, go ahead. Oh, you don't remember? Oh, sorry, okay. So the problem is now we need communication between the two threads. The thread that is associated with a timer needs to schedule something for the UI thread to execute. It needs to put an item in the queue or the things to do, the to-do list of the UI thread and go like, well, I'm the one, you know, who is associated with the timer. I know it's time to do something, but I can't do it. The only thing I can do is to tell you to do it. I'm gonna put a to-do item on your calendar, and that's the best, you know, that's the best I can do. Yep.
Okay, so the threads that we have now running are timer and timer task, right?
What?
We have user interface thread running.
Okay, so there are two threads running in parallel. Okay, so if you look at the timeline, we start with the UI thread. The UI thread is, you know, one of the two threads created for each process in Android. I cannot remember the other one, but there are two. The UI thread is one of the first ones to be initialized and running. So the UI thread, you know, would come along, and at one point it's going to call onCreate, and then later on, you know, it will call onResume. And then it will probably go at a place where it's going to rest until somebody actually clicks something on the screen or until there's something to do. So this point here, where it's waiting, is actually waiting for something to appear in this incoming queue of things to do. In other words, there's a to-do list associated with a UI thread, and every time it's done with doing something, it goes back to the beginning of that loop and say, oh, what else do I need to do? If there's nothing else to do, it will just go to sleep. If there are additional items to do, then it will go ahead and do those things. Okay, so the UI thread is basically, quote unquote, stuck in a loop, where the loop, at the beginning of the loop, it says, while there's another item in the to-do list, do blah, 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 and then it goes back and wait for another to-do item. Is that okay? Now, on resume, the way we do it here, on resume is going to start a new thread. That new thread is associated with a timer object. So we now have a timer object thread. And the timer object thread is going to execute run every second. Okay? So we got two threads. One is the UI thread. If you click on the label, this thread is going to say, oh, should I do something about it? Well, unless you set up a on, click listener, it's not going to do anything. But that's the UI thread. The timer thread is completely separate. And with this run here, the way we do it right now is having this run to try to interact with the user interface with the view object directly. But it can't, because only this thread can touch the view objects. This thread cannot. So now we have a problem, because when the thread that is aware of the time of when to do something cannot actually do it. So we need a way to basically say, every time we get to this run here, I'm going to use a dotted line here to mean this is some kind of indirect way to interact with the UI thread. So this run is going to interact with the UI thread and just put a little post-it of the to-do list of the UI thread and go like, well, this is something for you to do. And that's the best you can do. Yep.
It's kind of like a request.
Yeah, it's called a post. POST is kind of post. So it's going to post something to the thread of the user interface, of the user interface thread. Is that okay? So that's how we're going to fix this. So if we go back to the program that does work, okay, it has something that is very similar with only one minor difference. The minor difference is it has a my runnable, and the runnable is an interesting concept. When you look at the interface runnable, it's an interesting concept because it is just a class that has a run method. And my runnable is a variable that is used here. And then we also have a handler. So there are two additional concepts that is needed to fix the problem that we have. One is called a handler, and then the other one is, how do you associate something to run with a handler? Okay, so let's go back to here, and then we'll check out what is a handler. So an Android handler is actually an Android-specific concept, because you can see it is coming from the Android OS package and not coming from a Java package. So a handler is a class. It extends object, which means it's pretty high up in the hierarchy. A handler allows you to send and process message and runnable objects associated with a thread's message queue. Okay? Now this is important. This one sentence right here is telling us that, hey, this may be our ticket out of this little sticky situation. Because if you just kind of read the outer portion of the sentence and not really look into the specific names and the classes, it basically says it allows you to send something to a thread's message queue. Okay? And then the UI thread is stuck in a loop to wait for something to appear in its quote unquote message queue. So that means if my timer thread has a way to send a message to the message queue of the UI thread, then I have my solution to the problem. Okay? So handle is a major concept. Each handler instance is associated with a single thread. Now, this is also a very important concept because a runnable is nothing more than a class that has a run method. It is not attached. A runnable object or any object that is going through the runnable interface is not attached to anything. Okay, it's just an object. But a handler instance is always associated with a single thread, just like a timer has a thread associated with it. Okay, whoever is creating the handle is the owner, is the thread that the handle is associated with. So that means if the UI thread is creating a handle object, that handle object is now associated with the UI thread. Are we doing okay or not? Okay. And not only that, not only is it attached to the thread, but it's also attached to the message queue of that thread. Great, because that's exactly what we want, because we want something else to be able to interface with the UI thread and be able to say, hey, UI thread, you got something to do, here's a little post-it for you, right? This is our ticket, because what we want is to have the UI thread to create its own handle object. With that handle object, then the timer thread can say, oh, here's a handler object that is tied into the UI thread. I'll just use this as my way of communicating with the UI thread so that I can say, hey, UI thread, you got something to do now. Okay? So let's go ahead and modify our code with the program that does not work. Okay, so this is the one that does work. Let me close this one because I want to focus on the one that does not work, so I'm going to close this one. So now we only have the one that is currently not working. So with the one that is currently not working, I now have a handler, okay, that is, I'll just call it my handler, because I need to access this object from within the timer thread, so I need a property here. And the handler has two ways. This is not a logging handler, this is an OS handler, so we'll pick the right one. There we go. And I can do it here. I can do the initialization here, but I can also do the initialization later on, which is in onCreate. So I can do it over here. And I can say my handler is new handler. And that's it. So now we have a handler associated with it. And we'll switch back to Firefox. There are two main uses for handlers, schedule, messages, and runnables, okay? And runnables is what we want because we want to tell our UI thread, hey, this is exactly what I want you to do. And to enqueue an action to be performed on a different thread than your own, okay? Which is sort of what we need to do because we are now using the timer to schedule, the timer thread to schedule something. So when you go to the summary, we have handler, which is just a basic constructor. It constructs, but it doesn't really do anything. You can have a handler.callback so that you can specify what to do when it is callback. You can also go to here and use post, P-O-S-T. So post, what post does is it is only at the time, only when you call post from a different thread, then you can specify what a runnable, you can specify a runnable which contains a single method of run to tell the destination thread and say, hey, I want you to do this. Is that okay? So look at a runnable object, okay, whatever is going to be passing through to a runnable as an envelope that contains instructions. Who's going to do this? I don't know. The runnable itself doesn't know what thread is supposed to run it. It is simply an instruction. It's simply a run method that returns void with some kind of code. Okay? But it is putting this envelope, and post is like you sending the a mail through the post office. Okay? So post can be executed by any thread. It can be the thread that is the UI thread itself, the owner of the handle. It can also be any other thread. It can be the thread associated with a timer. So this allows the timer thread to include the instruction of what to do, put it into an envelope, and send it to the message queue of the thread that actually owns the handler object, which is the UI thread in our case, because the UI thread was the one that created the handler object, and therefore the handler object is linked with the UI thread and also its message loop, its message queue. Is that okay? Sort of? Okay. So knowing this now, we can now go back to our broken code, which is currently not working. And the my handler is now done. So what we need to do is now, you know, when the timer task is specified, we say, hey, when the timer is up and the timer task is running, and remember, when the timer task runs, it is inside the timer thread. Okay, this is from within the timer thread. The timer thread cannot touch anything directly, but it can post something to the UI thread and say, hey, you do it. I know what is supposed to be done, but since I cannot touch your objects, you do it. Okay, so now we can say my handler dot post. Okay, and what you're posting here is going to be a runnable. And a runnable is an interface, and we know how to create a anonymous class for an object that is being passed to an interface. So I'm going to use that trick here. So we can say new runnable, and then specify the code for this runnable. And inside the runnable, we just need a public. Okay, what is it complaining about? Class anonymous. Class derived from runnable must be, okay, it's just complaining that I don't have what it needs yet, okay. There we go, now he's happy. Okay, so it is extremely confusing because we're inside a run method and we are creating an object that fulfills an interface with its own run method, okay? Because what I'm doing, which is the run method I'm in right now, is telling somebody else what to do. Yep, go ahead.
I used autocomplete to do that just now, and it put in a half override. Does that matter, or would that do anything?
It does. With an interface, everything is at override. So it doesn't really matter when it comes to an interface.
That just means it's using the same name as something else?
It would give you an error if it wasn't spelled correctly.
Okay.
Right.
And it wouldn't give you that error if you didn't have the override.
Well, if you have a typo, if I have a typo here, like, you know, 2n, it will give me an error because I'm not supplying what the interface is expecting. Now, I can do something other than this, okay, right? I can do something like public, you know, void, yada, yada, and do some really crazy stuff here. It's okay. Because what a runnable really needs is just a void run method. If you supply like 20 gazillion additional things, it would just ignore that. It's like, okay,
if you
cool.
add override at the yaya, it's going to tell you it doesn't exist.
Right. So it's a good, you know, good way to check whether it is something that is expected from the interface. But other than that, you know, it's not as useful. So it's, once again, this is a programming style thing. You know, how much do you want to? How much help do you want from the Java compiler, basically? Okay, so this run method is important because this is the one that can touch UI objects. Because this code, this is the instruction that I'm putting into an envelope. I am the timer thread, by the way. Okay, so the timer thread is now specifying, writing down what to do, put it into an envelope, and then send it off to the UI thread. Okay, so when the UI thread checks its mailbox and go like, well, let's see what I can do today, it receives the package and opens up the envelope, and in the envelope is the run method that tells the UI thread what it needs to do. Oh, you need to change the counter.
Well, it executes in the scope of the UI thread.
It is, executed by the UI thread.
Right.
Because scope is kind of more of a static thing. I know what you mean. It's just, you know, nitpicking on the terminology a little bit. So now we can say, oh, okay, you now have access to label. So label is within the scope all the time. It's just which thread can actually touch it. The timer thread, scope-wise, has access to the reference, you know, has access to label, but at runtime, it cannot touch it because it's not the thread that created the view in the first place. So now we can do, you know, set text, and then we can say string to, string dot value of, and counter here. Now for those of you who are really, really kind of into, you know, I want to make my program as short and as cryptic as possible, you can do that. You have to love, you know, C++ and C for this kind of thing. You know, there are 20 gazillion things to do one thing, and then, but if you really want the most obscure code, that would take some thinking. But for those of you who really like to write cryptic code because it makes you feel you're smarter, try Perl. I think Perl is probably one of the most cryptic programming language because of the use of the at, the use of percent, and the use of dollar sign in front of an identifier. They all mean different things. And you can do it a cast by the use of that, you know, letter with that character. And it's just, it can write something that is really, really cryptic. Perl programmers are called monks. That tells you something about, you know, how much discipline you need to program in Perl, you know, effectively. And that's why people are switching to Python. Python effectively replaces a Perl, basically. There we go. Okay, so let's see if we can run this. And I think that's all we need to do. You know, the rest of the program can remain pretty much the same. Okay, so let's go ahead and give it a try.
You have my runnable stuff in your other program.
Yeah, the other program is probably just a little bit more complex than it needs to be. This one is, you know, pretty clean and simple. There we go. We have our timer running.
Does the other one not use post?
No, it does use post. It just has some extra stuff. It defines a class and it has some things, some extra stuff that is not 100% necessary. Okay, but we can compare those two programs. Okay, so this one does work. Are there any questions about this program? I think this is as simple as it gets if you want to have a timer to do something that is visible on screen. How does that compare to using a clock component in App Inventor? Well, but I think the major problem with this is not that you need subclasses and nested definitions and creating these anonymous classes and whatnot. It has to do with the concept of you have two threads that is completely hidden away from you when you're using App Inventor. When you're using App Inventor, you have no idea. You don't need to know there are multiple threads. One is called the UI thread, and that's the only thread that can touch, you know, anything that is on screen. And then the other thread, which is representing the timer, cannot do anything except to talk to the UI thread and say, there's something I want you to do. So I think this is one, you know, major difference between App Inventor and Android Studio, or proper Android programming, is, you know, you need to understand more about operating systems and what is happening behind the scenes when you're using Android Studio, as opposed to when you're using App Inventor. You know, this is all completely hidden from your view. Yep.
So I understand that my handler is there to provide an access way to the main activity, but could the my timer task run actually touch the members of main activity as long as?
Yes.
But then we have to follow critical sections and.
Yes.
Stuff like that.
That is correct.
Okay.
So within
the scoping, we can see it.
Yeah, certain things are thread safe, which means, you know, they can be running from different threads, and Java can automatically figure out, you know, okay, they cannot be both touching these objects at the same time. The only thing that there's no particular item here that both threads are touching at exactly the same time in this case, because counter in this case is only used by the timer thread. No, I take it back. This is only used in the UI thread, because by the time this executes, we're in the UI thread already. The timer thread is only using my handler to post something. And I think handler objects are automatically thread safe. Now we can check that and make sure. So this is this is handler. And we can look for thread save. Oh, it doesn't say thread save. Okay. I'm just gonna scroll through kind of fast here and see if there's any.
It has to be thread safe.
It has to be, because that's a whole
purpose.
I'm
putting in messages and you're taking them out.
Yep. Because its only purpose is to synchronize multiple different threads, but it's kind of interesting how they do not specify it is thread safe. But it is, they do specify thread safe in some of the other classes. Just not the one that is really obvious.
So we could cancel the timer, for example, if it's thread safe from inside the timer.
Yes. You can cancel the timer from either one, so you can click a button and have the user interface thread to cancel the timer or cancel a task.
Or after the timer expired so many times we can
right.
cancel ourselves.
Yep. So that can be done in any process. Yeah, in any thread. All right. So any questions about the program that we just wrote today, which is a very simple program. All it does is to keep track of a counter that is displayed on screen. But the underlying concept is what makes it complicated, that we have two threads. One thread can touch the user interface but is not aware of time. The other one, which is aware of time, cannot touch the user interface. So the key concept to make this happen is the concept of a handler, okay, which is basically a representation of a particular thread that has a message loop. And the runnable thing, which is what you put into the envelope to say, okay, this is what I want you to do, when you do get around to it. Any questions about what we talked about today? This is not an easy concept. In some way, I would say this is harder than the MVA, the Model View Adapter lecture. In some way, it is even more complicated than fragments, because this has to do with understanding the underlying concept behind a process, that you have the concept of threads, and one thread has a message loop that is waiting on a message queue, and then the other thread can only do something like, okay, I'm going to post something to your message queue, you do it while you get around to it. So I think that's kind of, it can be a more difficult concept, because we are not exposed to these things in the other programming classes. So are we good on this or not? Kind of? Okay, more or less. Cool. So I think next week, we'll start to touch on things that are happening in the background. How do you set up something that is not, it doesn't have a user interface, but yet, it is running, in the background, it can check things and it can do certain things. Like, when it's time, it will pop up something, alert you of something, that sort of thing. Because that's a very important concept as well. Right. Are we good? Sort of? Okay. So before we end the lecture, I do want to go back to the other one. And we'll just do a simple comparison of new projects can either be opened in a new window or replace. Okay, we want to open a new one. Because I just, sorry?
Oh, is there save as? Like, if you want to change the name of a project or save it as something else?
I think it is not quite as easy, because your packages cannot use the same name, or technically speaking, they should not use the same names. So you might not have you have to do a refactor if you want to change the names of the package or the stuff. Okay, so this one is slightly different. You can see, the only difference is I use my runnable and create it here, and then inside, I just reuse my runnable. Instead of creating a new runnable each time, I'm just reusing the same one. That's the only difference. Which is okay, because this is basically saying the instruction that I'm including in the envelope, that's only one piece. I'm not destroying it every single time and then recreating it every single time. as opposed to the other program, which is what it's doing.
So if you created the counter inside of the runnable, this one would work. But if we did it on the other one, it would keep reporting zero.
The counter as a part of the runnable?
Yeah, if you declared, instead of clearing the counter as part of the main activity, since all you're doing is setting the text, this one would continue to increment. But if you did it the other way and declared it locally, you'd have to declare it static if you wanted it to continue to increment.
Correct.
Because this is an instance that'll hold it.
Yeah, so in this case, you know, you can have, yeah, I see what you mean. So you, in this case, you know, you can have a new runnable.
And declare int
in
counter zero.
Can you do that? I don't think you can actually do that, because when you are, you're in an anonymous class, you can do that. So you have to initialize counter to a zero, and then, you know, use only that within the anonymous class. You're correct. Okay, so that is correct. So counter does not need to be associated with main activity anymore, because you can specify that, because the only place that has access to counter or needs access to counter is over here. Yep, so that is correct, that is.
Why is it collapsing the code like that? That's weird, huh?
Yeah, well, I think
it
has to do with,
it opens it up.
Yeah, so you can open it up. Because, you know, I think this kind of code is, it's just, you know, very, unnecessary, because a lot of times when you use this type of construct, you're only specifying what to do, and you're using a class to as a wrapper to wrap around it, so it only displays, you know, the code and not necessarily all the surrounding parentheses and whatnot. But you're right, you can probably do a, you know, instead of using a counter over here, you know, take out this counter. Okay. This is a good experiment to run, and instead you put the counter over here. And counter equals to zero. Yeah, that works. Yep. Good observation. All right.
Did a pretty good job with those little collapsing things. That's nice. You can do it from either the top or the bottom bracket.
Yep. And if you want to know, you know, what is a timer task, you can click this button, this one here. So this one would actually bring you to the definition of timer task. And okay, fine. So this is the actual, you know, Java source code file that is defining, you know, what is a timer task. So sometimes it's really handy, other times it can be confusing. You know, when you're dealing with something that's really complex, it can be confusing. Like this one here will bring you to the definition of the superclass of main activity, which is app compat activity. So this one is kind of, you know, longish, you know, because this is what is really happening when you have the super dot, you know, on create call. This is what is going on, which has its own super on create, because, you know, this is also a subclass of fragment activity. So fragment activity has its own on create. So then you can track it back to fragment activity, you know, its own, you know, on create, It has its own. It has a superclass as well. So this is a subclass of. Oh, where is it? Right here. Nope. Okay. Go all the way to the top. So this is a base fragment activity honeycomb. So when you click on that up button in on create.
That's it only honeycomb because you targeted honeycomb?
Yeah, I think I did.
So it does have to rebuild depending on the target.
Yep. Well, you cannot change it on the fly. You know, you cannot just, you know, right click on the project. You know, I did that once, I tried it. So you can go to open module settings, and it gives you the illusion that you can change it on the fly here. But you really cannot. if you change it here, you know, then it's gonna, you know, it can cause problems down the line. I did that. I was trying that, you know, in the previous class, and that didn't work out because it did not propagate the changes throughout the entire build. But this is a really cool feature. The first time I, you know, saw this was when Iraj was in my office. And he was, you know, clicking on stuff and go like, hey, what is this? You know, so he clicked on that and go like, oh, what am I seeing here? You know, how come we're getting more and more tabs? You know, this is complicated stuff. And then, you know, I just looked at that. So I looked at that and go like, okay, you know, he thought it was expanding the method and there's actually hidden code. And then I look at the top of the tabs and go like, no, this is from a different file. This is actually telling you, it's going back to the method definition of the superclass in this case. So you can track all the way back to, you know, what is exactly happening with onCreate and track your way all the way back to all the superclasses and find out exactly what is happening. Which is kind of cool, you know, because it really gives you a good understanding of how it works. You know, how it is under the hood. All right. Cool. All right. So is the homework assignment due today or is it due on the
27th?
On the 27th?
Yeah.
Okay. So you guys have a little bit more time to work on that one. Okay. Very good. Any? Yep.
Keep it the version that you did in class.
Yes. So let me close these first because they can be confusing. But one thing about this is they are slightly different in terms of color, kind of have a yellowish, you know, tint to it. So that's one thing that tells you that this is not actually within your project. It is actually the source code of the superclass itself. So let's go back to this one. Yeah, this is the one that is the kind of minimalist version, and it works. And where do you want me to go to? This is pretty much the...
Can you close off the bottom window so we can see more of that code?
Sure.
Or minimize it, yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, that's good. I can scroll up just a little bit.
Here we go. All right. So you guys have a nice weekend. You know, use the lab time to work on your homework assignment.
Next Monday, we're not
here. Ooh,
next Monday. I don't think we're here.
Okay, let me check that one first.
It's a holiday.
Yeah, I don't track those things. I just show on campus and go like, hey, nobody's here. Hey, I'm going home. I live close enough that I can do that.
Yeah, Washington's birthday is set right there on the...
Yeah,
okay.
Right.
Oh, okay. I see.
Washington's birthday, that's old, man. We used to have Lincoln's birthday, too, and then it became President's
Day. I thought I saw Lincoln somewhere.
Now it's going to be Trump
Friday.
Day.
Here we go.
Friday
so
well,
President's
yeah,
Day.
Weekend holiday. Calendar.
Yeah, but it says right here, ARC closed on Friday,
Fridays.
This Friday, and also next Monday. So you have a 4-day weekend. But it's going to rain, so forget about doing any type of yard work. All that weed is going to say, thank you. And you're just going to look at the weed and go like,
rrr. So have you seen this one?
Hmm?
Have you seen that one?
Nope.
2017. Yeah, I always buy them for the current year.
Oh, okay.
So it explains fragments slightly differently.
Okay. I will look into it.
It's kind of a help.
How does it explain fragments?
Differently than you did. That method that you had that you said you just had to implement, that says redefine the parameter, that's the way you communicate back from the fragment. So you overload that method and you can punch
did
it almost like the handler is here and then you jump into the other class and you handle the messages coming back from the fragment.
Right. Is that the one that has a URL, you know, type?
It says define your own type and override this method.
Yep.
Yeah, so that's how they talk backwards.
Right, but you still need to tie in the event listeners to trigger that one to execute.
Yeah,
you still
do the listeners and stuff.
Right.
And
yep.
But they have that specifically the method for communicating back from the fragment.
Right. Then you have to decode the URL to figure out, you know, what the fragment.
You can overload
is going
the
to tell
parameter
you.
To anything
right.
you want it to be. It could be URL,
right.
an integer, a class.
You can also change the method altogether because it really is just an agreement between the fragment that is a part of your components and also the activity which is contained in the fragment. So you can change all of that. You know, there's no set. Android does not impose a standard of how fragments can have to talk back to the activity.
Agreed.
Yep. Because I look into that and go like, there's no linkage whatsoever. It gives you the code, the shell of the code, the stubs, but it doesn't really trigger anything unless you tie it in to things that are actually in the fragment.
Yeah, there's no magic here.
Yep, there's no magic.
We gotta wire it all together ourselves.
Yep, there's no autofill.
Okay.
Yep.
But you can click, you know, add constraint layout by the name.
Okay, so that,
yeah, go ahead. Try to rebuild or refresh the layout.
And then I got
Android Studio?
Yeah.
It'll be on the browser.
Oh, right. Thanks.
Too many tabs.
There we go.
There you go.
Is this it?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I've got a similar issue with the fragment. Even without this thing, it'll say the same kind of thing.
Okay. Could not find constraint dot dash layout. Okay. So let's see if we need to update it.
Oh, I had a similar issue like this before.
Uh huh.
And I added it said what's the beta version.
Yeah.
And then it.
See next one this.
It just started working.
Thanks, helpful.
Sorry, this isn't it.
Okay. Well, let me check if there's an update.
Yeah, it updated it today.
And it wants to be updated again.
Excellent. So I tried to get, I'm still sick. I've been sick all week. I'm trying to get this stuff working at home. My computer doesn't seem to have the processing power to even run this thing.
Yeah, that's what Iraj complained to. Iraj said, you know, unless you have at least 8 gigs of RAM,
yeah,
if you're doing this in Windows,
yeah, my problem.
Yeah.
Yeah, forget it.
So wait, you think it would work smoother if I use the Linux boot on my piece of crap laptop?
Well, this is Linux. We can check out how much RAM it's actually using. Okay, so let's do this. Which one is that? Fragment?
Yeah.
Okay. Gradle project sync, you know, with some errors, open message view, show log. Constraints on in a given relative layout should reference other views within the same relative layout, but not itself.
Okay. I didn't mess with any of this code, by the way. I made a fragment and then I tried to build it.
And then this is the fragment, which has an ID of fragment. seems to be working now. At least the previous seems to be working. So we make it, still won't make it. Could not find some part of the screen. I have seen cases where we can check for updates multiple times and it will still be updated, but that's not the case. We have to delay this version. Unzip it again from the zip file. Have you made any changes?
This is a permanent zip file. I made this.
Oh, you made this?
Yeah.
Okay.
But there is one from a zip file that had the same issue, so we can totally look at that one. I'm going to test that one.
Okay.
If they close this out, or even just open recent. Yeah.
Close first.
What's that? That's the one that was right here.
This one?
Yeah. That's a very frustrating when I try to download an example and the example is perfect.
Failed to resolve, and it's the same constraint issue. This one is resolved. It is now resolved. So we go to app source resource layout. This one is now resolved. Which kind of looks kind of odd. And it's complaining about runtime exception AAP. Process not waiting to receive command. And I have seen this one before too. And it failed. Let's just get out of here. Because that's Android Studio itself getting an exception.
Why would that happen?
You have an icon to start your account.
Yeah, the emulator is working. I'm trying to connect this, but
I can make the emulator work.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. The way to, it has that rendering problem.
Yeah.
But I can show you how to use an emulator. At least yes, in school, you can go to VVD manager. Instead of using the auto, you just hard code into your software. That always works. The only downside of using the software is it's going to run a little slower, so if your app is very screen intensive, it can make a difference. But if you're dealing with a normal, just your typical user interface app, it's not going to make any difference. But this does allow you to run the emulator in the classroom. And if your home computer has virtualization support from the processor, you should be able to use this option as well.
It depends on which processor. Is it an Intel or AMD processor?
It's an AMD.
Yeah, if it's an AMD, it has to support, they call it differently, you know, there's a different term for that. So you have to look for any particular flag of the processor. But it is handy to do it, you know, through a virtual device. And we could finish for a while.
I tried to download Android Studio like a year ago to get it working.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't get the emulator to work, but I didn't realize I could just look up my phone
mm-hmm.
with USB, so I just didn't, you know,
yep.
work well.
So while it's doing this, I can just look it up on my phone too. What is AAPT? Because that's a common mode of failure. I don't know why it takes so much time to save the AVD configuration. Because it happens to every single computer that I have, so it's not the processing capability of the computer itself. So do you want to debug it on your phone, or?
If we can get the
Yeah. These computers are actually pretty fast, so.
Do you know if the computer lab is open on Saturday?
They open on Saturday.
Because I'm thinking I can't work on it on Friday because campus is closed, but I can take it in my boot drive.
Oh, you mean this Saturday?
Yeah.
That I don't know.
I think it is. I think that's the way these things usually work. Maybe I'll just call them on Saturday.
Or you can just go to the lab and ask them. Yeah. Well, it depends on which AAPT we are talking about. The one from version 21.0.1 has a bug. It crashes under while building certain projects.
Oh my god.
Yep, but there are people who resolved it. Go. It does seem a bit slower than on my computer. Might be your flash drive. Are you using an external hard drive or
no,
a thumb
drive?
Those are usually slower, especially when you try to run the virtual machine from it.
Yeah.
Because that's IO intensive. Okay, so now we have the virtual machine running. Doing something that's really IO bound.
It said this before you hit run.
Okay. So you go to SDK manager, click SDK well, it's supposed to be running. I don't know exactly whether it's doing it or not, because I, you know, give it a little bit more time. Just pick, you know, devices of, you know, different sizes. You know, pick the most representative ones. So you pick it, you know, the Nexus 5 is a very typical 1080p resolution 5-inch-ish type of device. Then you can test it on a smaller, you know, screen, and then test it on the tablet type of device. But there's no, I don't think, you know, there's a need to test it on every single device, because, you know, if you test it on a larger device and test it on a smaller device, probably will work fine, you know, on everything that is in between. I think Gradle has stopped, but I'm not sure because it's still spinning. And we have had that problem too, you know, from before. It's like Gradle just wouldn't stop. Test it. We can tell what type of process is actually running and taking up time. Okay, so QEMU is your virtual machine. So the virtual machine is taking up some time, and then the Java virtual machine, which is running this, is also taking some time, but nothing is near substantial. Okay, 9%, 4%. It looks to me that it is doing something. Probably something that's I/O intensive, and that's why we could not see actual processing time being used. But it's hard to tell. It could be your flash drive being slow, and it's just, you know, kind of tying down the process, or it could be something else that is happening. So from here, I can't really tell. Copy your project onto my machine and see if I can open it from here.
Well, that wouldn't help me very much as far as doing that.
Well, at least, but it can tell you whether, you know, an external hard drive will help or not. Because it might be just an issue with the device itself. It's too slow.
Well, I could use my phone. I just wanted to know why this wasn't working.
Well, it is possible that the virtual machine is soaking up too much, you know, I/O bandwidth, so that, you know, there's not enough left for Gradle to use. That's possible. So now that the virtual machine is gone, we can see that something else is taking that space. And Java itself, which is running Android Studio, is not taking up a lot of time. It doesn't look like it is trying very hard to do something. Canceled the Gradle, and it does use up less time now. still a Java process?
Yeah, it's
yeah. And two Java process. Oh, okay. That should kill all of those. There's still a Java process. I wonder what is two Java processes. So there's some leftover processes. Are they gone now? No. Let's do that big one. You can see how much RAM is taking. Okay. So we got one process still running, and it is it's a Java Studio. It's a Gradle. Yes. You can see it's a Gradle daemon that's still running. Update here?
Yeah, and it's worked before.
Okay. Does it show that it's charging? Because
yeah.
If it shows it's charging, that's, you know, that means USB is connected.
Yeah, sometimes.
It's kind of finicky.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah, but it's finicky.
Yeah.
The moment I
yeah.
leave it alone,
yeah,
yeah. Now it's fine.
Yep.
Okay, all right, so you need a new cable.
Yep. Need a lot of new things.
Okay. Because, you know, this means, you know, you can be halfway debugging your app and it comes loose. You might need a duct tape.
The other cable I have is about a foot long.
Okay. Yeah, that's not. Well, you can still use that because we have all of these extension cables, so it will still be usable. Yeah. So that would work. All right. So this project seems like it's okay. You know, it's displaying all the stuff correctly.
Okay.
So that's
let's yeah. Let's see if we can
correctly.
Build the fragment.
To me.
but let's see.
Okay, but it says right here, Gradle
yeah.
project sync completed with some error. Open the messages view. Of course, there's nothing there. There's show log. Okay. This is the same message that we saw with the other one, and it is resolved. Okay, so string layout. Okay, so this is a known problem. They know how to fix it because you can see what it's downloading. Solver. Which means, yeah, we knew we kind of goofed up here. Here's a solver. Take it and fix the problem. Okay, still has rendering problem. Okay, could not be instantiated.
such method error. And where it's important to then solver widget. So the solver itself is not working. Project builds just fine. It's just that when we look at the layout of the activity, then we have a problem because we can see there's a project and we go to apps, resources, layout. This is the only one that has a problem. Rendering problems. Sounds to me that it's a support class constraint layout and not be instantiated. Rendering problems, the following classes cannot be instantiated, and we can stack them. What a lame out-of-the-box experience in Android Studio. Okay, this is a known bug since Android Studio built 1.1. Okay.
trying to do is build some point using an earlier API. This is a project that you started from scratch.
Yep.
And when did the problem start to happen? As soon as you drag in the fragment?
Yeah.
Okay, so the fragment is not there, and it should not have that problem.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go ahead and remove things until it starts to work. So you have a constraint layout, but there's nothing in the constraint layout. So we can take it out. Closing tag. Okay. So that is, that fixes your problem. Still have a frame layout, but it's not a constrained frame layout. All right, so that means if we try to do it again, then we have a problem. some people seem to be suggesting it has to do with the SDK version. About the AAPT process. Ready to proceed.
Do you think this one does?
Mm-hmm.
And this one also.
So let's look that up. Some people downgraded to version 23.0.3, and that seems to fix the problem.
Okay, so I should try downloading a different version of Android Studio?
Yeah, well, they said if you just change one little thing in Gradle, that will change it. The build tool version in a Gradle file would specify the build tool version.
Well, I have some time to play with it this weekend, but I have a test too. So, thank you for leaving this with me. If I can't get it working for, you know, next Monday, I don't see how I'm going to do the homework, but I'll just try.
Mm. Yeah, but it does look like, you know, a lot of people changed their build tool version. And it's under here. Build tool version. So a lot of people changed that.
I don't have the earlier version.
Yeah.
So.
But that's what, you know, these people are reporting.
Has anybody else in the class complained about this? Has anybody else just dealt with no problem or have yet or what?
I think different people use different versions. You know, they use the API level of the app itself is different for different people. Some people try to pick an earlier version, some people pick the latest version. And right now, I think Gradle itself may not be working because it seems to be taking way too long for Gradle to finish what it's supposed to do. So there might be some multiple issues. And then the thumb drive is also a slow device, so I'm not really sure whether it's just not done because the thumb drive is slow, or whether it's, you know, dead and that's why it's not running. But the build version is one thing that most people suggest to change it first, is to change it back to 23. And so you might want to give that a try.
Is there a way to download 23 without just, how do I just download one build version?
It already has that version. So when you go to right click on the project, go to Open Module Settings. That's not yet. There we go. Gradle version. So that's one thing. And that's not what we. There we go. go to build version, you know,
this one. 23.0.0, right?
Yep.
But I don't know the 23.0.0.
It won't tell you that you have this option to select unless you have it available, I think.
How do I get it?
It's in your Android SDK manager. So when you go to SDK tools,
okay.
And I think the build tool is specified here. So platform tools, tools. And then you only have the latest platform too. So one suggestion is to go back to an earlier one. You just go to, I go all the way back to Jelly Bean. It seems to work better, you know.
Okay.
Because those have been around for longer.
Right.
Yeah. So that might actually be a way they can address this issue, is to kind of just fall back and not use the latest. Because 7.1.1 is bleeding edge. That's still being fixed right now. But you can't change the platform, once you have a project.
Oh, so I'd have to try it again.
Yeah, so
okay,
you have to kind of.
Very best.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. If all fails, you know, upload the project, you know, just zip it up and upload it to your Google Drive. Send me a link to your Google Drive location so I can try it on my side and see if it's an issue with the project itself or whether it's the setup of Android Studio. Yeah, I look at mine and it's definitely using an older build tool version, you know, 23.0.3, and the SDK is only back to a Marshmallow, not all the way back to Jelly Bean, but it's still older. So I would use the older version of the API. Home computer, you can be, unless you have enough RAM, you can be running out of